Thank you, Burkhard, for your kind introduction. Thanks to the organization for giving us the opportunity to give this talk. So today, I would like to start from the very beginning for those of you that are not so familiarized with the idea or concepts of coevolution. So this is a concept that Darwin himself promoted. He was very, very, he knew very well that interaction between different species and ecological interactions could be really important for explaining the evolution and a point in which natural selection can even make a stress. And so this is the typical example in which the streaking parallelism that he detected between the nectary length and the proboscis length of the pollinators and the orchids, he stressed this kind of things and even devoted a whole book for this subject. But at the end, the definition that we can work with is something like this one by John Thompson, that this is reciprocal evolution between interacting species driven by natural selection. So, interestingly, 50 years later, Fahrenthal realized that, in fact, this kind of relationships could have an effect on the phylogeny and the evolutionary history of the species, and that this effect could be could have the form of this parallelism in the trees, these tree similarities. This is an example of gophers and lices. But at the end, the interesting point for us today is that almost 80 years later, people realized that in fact this kind of relationship could be also found at the molecular level, at the protein level. So that at least in some cases there was the observation that protein families that are interacting can show very similar trees, phylogenetic trees, and this was the starting point of a field for predicting protein-protein interaction based on these similarities. This is something that we have been working for a long time right now, but this is not the point that I'm going to speak to talk about today. But the thing that is more trendy now and it's more interesting probably is the one that started with the observation that these parallelisms can be also observed at the residue positions. And so that you can observe that, for example, in the positions 29 and 33, there are actually a change in a position when you find a change in one position, you can find also a change in the other position. And these parallelisms with the starting point for those methods that are looking for residue-residue coevolution. And in fact, this kind of coevolution can be explored not only within proteins and but also between different proteins, and there are also a number of works trying to deal with this kind of scenario in which the methods are basically identical, but the challenge here is try to detect which are the actual pairs, interacting pairs, so you can detect these parallelisms. So at the end, there have been a number of different approaches trying to deal with this scenario. And these are the two more popular ones and basic ones. The one in which you can consider the actual level of similarity of the changes in between different positions. That is the first one. That was the one that was actually developed by Alfonso and among others. And the second one that is based on mutual information. And it's more focused on trying to see which are the similarities in the frequency change, in the changes in frequencies. And anyhow, both of these methodologies at the end provide some clues about the possible putative protein contact map of the protein. And this is the kind of information that has been trained to be used in the context of protein structure prediction. And although useful, it has been also quite limited up to recently. One of the problems that the field has been dealing with are quite well known. The first one is the problem of misalignment. So when you have a problem in your alignment, it's very easy that you are going to detect the spurious correlations, especially if there is a shift in the conservation in a conserved position or a number of conserved positions, like in the first example. But even more important, probably, or more fundamental, is the issue of the phylogenetic relationship between or evolutionary relationship between the homologs that you are using to study these relationships. So, as it becomes evident, the closer the sequences, the more likely that they are going to have the same residue in the same position. So, this is going to generate a tendency to find out spurious correlations, probably also. So, there have been a number of different approaches trying to filter out this effect and correct the covariation considering this effect. And one of the most successful is the one by Dunn et al., in which they were able to show that actually they improve significantly the prediction of protein contacts and number of families. Anyhow, the recent breakthrough comes from a different problem and a different perspective that is the one that is coming from the actual nature of covariation and any global similarity measure, in which basically we can see very clearly that this is transitive. So if you have if you have a similarity or codependence in our case between this position and between this position and this other one, so it's quite obvious that just by the transitivity you are going to find also a similarity here. And when you include more positions, the scenario becomes even more complex. And in fact, this problem was detected and explained and posed by Lapides in 1999. And in fact, he proposed a method to deal with these situations that come from physics. But at the end, it was not able to deal with real long proteins, just for about 10 amino acids long sequences. But anyhow, this was really a valuable contribution that was unacknowledged by the field for a long time. Until I'm going to enter into details of the methods. For there's people here that is giving talks about this, like Deborah Marx and Martin Waite. That is actually in this paper, Martin Waite is the and collaborators actually rediscovered this problem and proposed a practical solution for this problem that was able to improve clearly this contact prediction. And in fact, after this, a number of different developments in the field have improved these methods and have even made it even better. But the problem here is that, well, the problem, the point here is that this prediction for the first time in history was able to be used for correctly predicting de novo structures. And in fact, the quality was good enough so that you could combine these predictions with the secondary structure information that comes from people like Burkhardt and try to use these as constraints for guiding the process of folding simulations and actually retrieve a number of very, very nice models. So in fact, these are the RMSD values that are quite striking and quite impressive. So at the end, this was the point for these methods, but these methods have their good and their bad points, not bad, that is the limitations. So of course they are producing exciting results, and this is great for the field and for the application of this data, but at the same time they require many sequences, at least 1,000 sequences, and so they have been particularly useful in the context of transmembrane proteins, as Deborah and Nugent, Marx and Nugent, Tim Nugent showed yesterday. because this is the only kind of problem in which we have many sequences, but we are not able to get the structure experimentally easily. So this is a wide field for the application of these methods. And at the same time, they are also used at the domain level. That is something about the interaction between different domains that remains to be explored. But at the same time, these methods have been also used for predicting protein interfaces. In fact, the first paper by Martin Waite was dealing with a two-component system. But unfortunately, it's very difficult to do this kind of prediction because, in fact, it's quite difficult to get enough protein pairs to build these alignments with 1,000 sequences. But of course, we hope that in the future this can be used in different contexts. But this is a great breakthrough, and it is amazing. And we really enjoy seeing that the field is actually able to fulfill this kind of previous expectations. But at the same time, we think that there is something that we are losing in this view, and this is the view of the group of covalent residues. And this comes from even from the ecological point of view also, although we are also looking for protein contacts and or interaction between species, or we are thinking in pairs. And even although we are trying to consider a whole set of interaction to detect which are the right contacts or the right pairs, at the end we know that convolution is also happening at the level of groups. And these groups are forming this kind of webs and networks, like these mutualistic networks that are the current study of is currently studied in ecological evolution. But we have also somehow related concepts at the molecular level. And here we realize that the kind of methods that have not been previously thought in the context of convolution are actually pointing to these kind of positions. And for example, these methods like SDPs, those that are devoted to detecting specifically determining positions, that is a quite big number name, that are these positions that are conserved within a subfamily, differentially conserved within subfamilies, but they are different between different subfamilies, are actually coming in groups, so that when we run the methods that I will discuss later, we are obtaining this kind of positions, group of positions that are actually showing similar patterns that are actually covariant. So this kind of covariant positions that are not the kind of things that you are usually going to detect by the previous methods have been the problem that has been addressed by different methods, and most of the original methods were using the actual phylogenetic trees, but there are some original methods and some developments in this view that come from multivariate analysis of this multivariate alignment that are actually giving us the opportunity to deal with this problem in a more robust and a more consistent way. So this is one of the methods that I'm including here that is not usually included in these categories is the statistical coupling analysis. This is sort of a different method. This is not specifically looking for this kind of positions that are actually conserved between different subfamilies and differentially conserved between different subfamilies, but they are detecting this kind of situation. So they are positions that are conserved within a given subfamily. This is not explicitly discussed in the papers, but is actually what we think that they are doing. And in fact, we found that there are striking similarities between these methods, both in the case of the methods based on sequence space, that was this original publication by Casari, Sander, and Alfonso. And that we have developed in a more systematic, automatic, and robust way to be able to perform a multivariate analysis of a multiple sequence alignment. So for this, we will retrieve two different spaces that are related, one for sequences and one for positions, that are of reduced dimensionality, but they are highly informative. They are the techniques that are related with PCA, although this is not exactly the same that we are using here. Anyhow, this kind of treatment allows us to detect these subfamilies here using clustering algorithms. And so we can use this information to detect the SDPs at the same time. So this kind of approach allows us to perform a large scale evaluation of the implication of this position in different contexts. And in fact, we realized that we observed that they were clearly associated to ligand binding sites, but also with protein interfaces. So this kind of positions were very interesting to see. But at the same time, we have all these other methods, like the different developments of SCA. Okay. Of SCA that are actually doing something sort of similar. They get a matrix that is enriched for conservation somehow, and they perform a multivariate analysis. This is a spectral decomposition when they are able to detect these positions that are actually close in this space, that are the positions and that are co-conserved in these subfamilies. And they have been able to prove that in some cases, at least, these are defining domains, not exactly structural domains, but there's just a convolution or co-conserved domains that they called protein sectors, and that they were able to see that are actually implied in different roles. Some of them are functional and others are structural, and they are doing very nice experiment on this and trying to see the implication of this on the evolution of allosterism. So anyhow, these methods require manual inspection to know why these positions are related, because they are involved in very different contexts, but they are poor predictors of actual links of contacts, because they are dealing with groups, not with links, but they are pointing to more communication-like and these kind of things. Anyhow, so this is the global view of all the methods, and even those that I haven't discussed today. But this provides us a view that there is a richness of methodologies that are able to provide information about almost every different level of protein function and protein structure, and that this is also related with how they deal with the coherence of the phrenetic trees, phrenetic history. Those that are devoted to pairs are quite independent of this information, but those that are devoted to groups are mostly taking advantage of this. So at the end, and this is my last slide, so I would like to end with words of people that are far smarter than me. So this is the most well-known quote in biology and in evolution. So nothing in biology makes sense except in the light of evolution. This is another well-known quote by Linus Pauling. Life is a relationship among molecules and not a property of any molecule. I would like to stress here that, in fact, coevolution is about biological objects speaking evolution with each other. So this is the ideal tool to interrogate about these problems. And in fact, we think that this is telling us that we actually need a common conceptual framework for understanding this protein, this kind of interactions and all the different kinds of functional and molecular interactions, and that coevolution is the way. So at the end, we think that this common framework needs to deal with the things that the field is now working with. So this is this different point of view of pairs versus networks, codependence versus communication and coordination, and of course we need to integrate different evolutionary levels from the protein level, residue level, species level, all these kind of things. I think that this is the point. So at the end, this is the end of the talk, and I just would like to acknowledge the people I've been working with, Alfonso, of course, and Florencia, that is the people that have been pushing on this subject for a long time, and the guys that are part, that have done part of the work that, in our lab and in our collaborations, and of course to the insightful comments by Jose Onuchit, David Jones, Chris Sander, and Eric Van Iwen, that are part of the compilation of the ideas behind the review, and of course to all the authors that are doing this so excited and this fun. So this is. So,
Yeah. I remember that Professor Valencia was talking about this coevolution in different proteins and so on. And I remember that some company would tell him, we don't know where these proteins interact. Mm-hmm. And he would say, give me 10 sequences of each and I will be able to solve it. Now you say that it's really difficult. So what has changed, or what's?
Well, Okay. Well, this is a difficult question to repeat. So he says that some years ago, I guess.
Yeah. The sequences wasn't enough for finding the phase where two proteins interact 10 years ago. Uh-huh. But now you say it's really difficult.
Well, I think that is difficult because. First, because I guess that Alfonso didn't know, I didn't know that that this kind of indirect association would be so relevant for discriminating real covolving residues. And at the end, this kind of indirect associations can only, at the moment at least, can be only solved by adding a lot of statistical information. So you need a lot of sampling, and for this you need many sequences. So this is the frequentist approach, or this is the one that is started with mutual information, and it works very well if you have many sequences. So at the moment this is the...
Allow me to step out of my role.
Yeah, and which is...
And I would talk about that.
Okay. You were there.
So stepping out of the role, if as long as we stay to the issue of predicting, so the question really is, you say, or you, the statement is, you say it's complicated to predict protein-protein interactions. 10 years ago, you said you could almost do it. Now you say you can almost do it. So what's the big breakthrough? That's one summary of what you say. And the big breakthrough really is in the field of protein structure prediction. Nobody has ever predicted a structure for an entire thing as big as a membrane protein before May 2012. That's the Cell paper from the group of Debbie Marks and Chris Under. For the first time in history, we have 11 structures or 18 structures out there for which nobody ever had seen the structure before. It's a completely, would not have been possible with comparative modeling. So they tried for the entire PFAM. Of the entire PFAM, they could do only 11, you couldn't say. But you can say they could do 18. We have never seen as many. So it depends on where you stand. By the way, one thing that I'd like to add to what you said, David said they need over 1,000. Yes, over 1,000 proteins in the alignment. That's true. In fact, for them, 10,000 and 50,000 makes a difference. So it's even more than over 1,000. And we have somebody else here. Maybe you're better even able to answer this question because you work more on protein interactions than you want to step up. So my first statement really here is what we have changed is the way we can predict structures. To carry it from here to the interaction, are you want to take the stand on that one?
What shall I say?
I don't know. What do you believe? Are we doing better for protein interactions?
Okay, there are 2 points about the number of sequences. One is...
Come.
Okay, I go here. The methods as they are at the moment, they just need, for being precise, a lot of statistics. And it's just the problem is that it's a relatively sophisticated, let's say, analysis. And if you have small errors on calculating correlations, you get big errors on this deconvolution of direct things. I decided 2 hours ago to speak about this a bit in my talk tomorrow, so I make some publicity for you. Because we have maybe some way to get the numbers lower. But What else?
It's David. 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 I'm sorry, David. Yeah,
so
that
so
I,
no, I just no, yeah.
No, you are the guys.
So I think it's clear. There's a point where we have a breakthrough, and there's a point where maybe if we do a little bit more, we're going to have a breakthrough tomorrow. But again, the point that David made very, 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 very clearly is, so we are talking about 10,000 proteins. Now, if you talk about protein interactions, you need 10,000 of the same, okay? And paradox don't work. So most of the families of the membrane proteins
If they interact, they work. So you have to have pairs which you know they work. Yeah. Actually, in the first word.
So that, that blows up what you need. So it makes
but,
it
but
more
you have to pair the paralogs. Yeah. And that's,
that's the problem. That's the problem.
Maybe you are better in that sense.
But anyway, so one thing is clear. I'm clearly an agnostic who would not have believed that there would be a moment for breakthrough and that just physics would do it. Here we have a representative for my view of one of these outsiders who came from physics. And help to change the world. So why shouldn't it happen again for protein action? I believe the major message from you, David, is we need a common framework.
This is something that we decided not talk about today. But in fact, we did a similar approach.
Thanks
Martin. Thank you. We followed a similar approach more or less at the same time. We didn't know about your work, and probably you don't know about that work. And we didn't know about Lapides. And what we were trying to detect was which of these three similarities were actually specific. And in our mind was not also related with the indirect effect, but also with groups of covalent residues. This is why we are still thinking in this direction. So we think that there are a number of these relationships that are actually coming from the fact that they actually are a selection unit. So they say, so they are factors that are affecting to these proteins as a whole, and so they show this kind of common effect. So we proposed a similar approach, but using partial correlation and not so elegant and yours. But I think that is also more or less the same idea.
Okay.
Thank you.